Father, the devil's been busy this morning. From internet lines down to buttons coming off a shirt sleeve. Just little aggravations to try to distract us. And Father, if that's been going on in my world, it's probably been going on in the lives of others who are here today. Things that could have prevented them from coming today, except they were single-minded in their purpose of what was important for this morning for them. And so we're grateful. Father, you knew who was going to be here today, and what you have to say to us through your scriptures and through your worship is just for us. And so I pray that our hearts will be open to that which you want to reveal in our lives. So I trust this day, I trust this morning to you, and I do so in the incredible, marvelous, matchless, perfect, unbelievable name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Walking down the aisle a minute ago, I was handed a little cartoon. Let me share it with you, from Pickles. There's an old couple facing off with each other in their living room. He's dressed with a blue shirt and a tie, and she's ready to go. And she says, "You can't go to church like that." He looks down and says, "Like what?" She says, "You got mustard on your tie and your shirt is wrinkled. Your shoes aren't polished or tied." He says, "It's called casual church. Look it up, dear. It's a thing. You're a thing." That was cute. Hey, as I've told you, man, all I care about is you're dressed when you come to church, all right? Because for most of us, that other suit needs to be pressed. So, anyway. I told you, man, there are things going on today that are unbelievable. Welcome to New Hope Church. It is great to have you with us. If you are a guest today, your first time here, thanks for coming. There's a guest card in the pew. I would love for you to take it, fill it out, drop in the offering bag. We promise not to harass you or annoy you, but through the mail, we're going to send out some information we hope will answer questions about what we believe and what we do. And if you still have a few questions, then you can call us, and we'll try to fill in the blanks for you there. But thanks for doing that. Hobby Lobby, we have secured another table. There were four of you last Sunday, so that means we have room for six more. This is for the luncheon where Mark Green, the CEO and son of the founder of Hobby Lobby, is going to be speaking at a CBMC luncheon on September the 29th. So you can see Gene Sperling for tickets after the service. He'll be happy to get your name down. We only have, I think, six spots left for that. Next Sunday is Africa Sunday. 1040i, their president is going to be with us, Mike Cousineau, and talking about next year's trip in February, the medical mission trip. And next Sunday night, the eight of us, except I think there'll only be six of us here, six out of the eight of us will come back that evening. We're going to share our story, show you some pictures. Mike Cousineau will be with us that night, answer some other questions. And following that, we're going to have homemade ice cream. All right? Because after we talk about 125-degree days, we're going to want to cool down just a bit. Here's the problem. Because the internet was down, I couldn't transfer my sermon from my desktop to my iPad. So I had to retype that in my iPad. Everything I'd done once, I had to do again. The other thing I couldn't do was I couldn't send from my desktop to the printer. I couldn't even print a hard copy of my sermon, all right? So what that also meant was I could not print a copy of sign-up sheet for homemade ice cream freezers for next Sunday night, all right? So here's the way we're going to do this. This is faith. If you would be willing to bring a gallon or gallon and a half, whatever your ice cream freezer makes, if you would be willing to bring some homemade ice cream next Sunday night at 6 o'clock, we had three in the 8 o'clock service. How many in this service would be willing to bring a freezer of ice cream next Sunday night? Raise your hand. One, two. Hey, they only had 65 over there in that service. Okay, there's three. Can I guilt a fourth one? I got four. Okay, very good. All right, good. Guilt and shame. We're going to talk about that in the sermon today. But that's later, okay? Good, we got that. We got four. Okay, so I'm not going to call you because I won't remember whose hands just went up, okay? But we're going to get there. We get four in the next one, we're good to go. There are a couple of signed-up sheets going around. This top one is really quick. It's next Sunday morning. If you're a motorcycle rider and after the 8 o'clock service you want to go on a motorcycle ride, they're going to stop and get your digestive juices flowing at the Chuck Wagon in Sanger with a big chili dog. And then they're going to move on to Hanford, and they're going to go to Superior Dairy, where you're going to settle all that rumbling with the biggest banana split you can imagine, all right? So that's what they're doing next Sunday after the 8 o'clock service, all right? You changed it on me. Oh, looky there. Read the directions. Okay. So you may need to call those folks on there from the 8 o'clock service, okay? So that's a lunch trip. So after the last service, sign up, let them know that you're going to go, okay? Underneath that is a sign-ups for Wednesday morning women's Bible study. At the bottom of this list is the Tuesday night women's Bible study. It's already been around for a couple of weeks. Here's the deal. This year they're going to do something the women have never done before. They are going to offer the very same Bible study on Wednesday morning that they're doing on Tuesday night. Okay, so all the women who show up to both studies will be studying the same thing. So you all have something else to talk about. All right? So, what they're studying are the 12 women of the Bible. I think there were more than 12, but they're going to cover just 12. Okay? Anyway, so the 12 women of the Bible. So those are the sign-up sheets, and those are going around. All right? Today, after we're finished in the last service, this is Widow to Widow Luncheon. This is going to be at Todd's Barbecue in the Barnyard, all right? So that's just north of Shaw on Clovis Avenue. You've already seen the film clip. If you got here on time, you saw the film clip of The War Room, new movie that's being released, and we have a special presentation for our church family and the ladies from our, all right? And you can see Fawn after the service or some ladies out there at the table right through these double doors, and you may get your tickets. They're $5. $5 to go see the movie with a group of ladies from New Hope Church. Bring a friend. Great way to do that. You saw better today than last week on the clip what the movie's about. It's stories of people's lives kind of intertwined together and the power of prayer in the adventure of those lives. In September, on September the 13th, is going to be Baptism Sunday. If you have invited Christ into your life and you've never been baptized and you would like to be, in order to be baptized on September the 13th, this is kind of your last day to let us know. Take one of the cards in the pew in front of you, put your name on it, check Baptism, September 13th, and then we're going to get you some information that tells you how that day works, and we'll also get some invitations in your hand that you can mail out to family or friends that you would like to have join you on that particular day. A few prayer requests. Karen Mansfield. She took her mom home earlier this week under hospice care, and in late night hours of Friday night, early morning hours of Saturday morning, Karen's mom went home to be with the Lord. She had told her in the hospital, "I'm ready just to go to heaven." And so she is there today. We are so grateful for that. Shelly's dad will start his treatment this week, unless there's another change, and we hope not. But anyway, those treatments should start this week for his lung cancer. Jackie Hopelian's father's memorial service will be this Saturday here at the church. Jerry Brown, you're walking upright. It's good to see you. All right, anything scheduled next? Okay, all right, so test on Tuesday. Continue to pray for Jerry. It's great to see Shirley. We prayed for her last week. All right, she's up and at him today. Orville Little, we had his memorial service yesterday. So that's Glenn and Janet Mattson's father and father-in-law. So just continue to remember their family. We have our youth pastor with us today. Coming up stage, all right, to chat with us. Pastor Bishop just got back from Hume Lake Youth Camp with all of our junior hires, and he's got a testimony to share.
So, awesome part about being a team, we're sitting in back, and I know as a team, Pastor Tim, I'm right there with you. I wouldn't remember who's going to bring ice cream, but as a team, we decided in the back, these little Connect cards, if you raised your hand, just so, to give this man some peace this week, just let us know you're going to bring ice cream, you put it on your Connect cards. We'll work that out.
Good job. Hey. Good job, Chris.
Teamwork, not me.
All right, I love
teamwork,
it, babe.
Not me. So I had this awesome opportunity to go up to Hume Lake this week and hang out with 37-ish teenagers, junior high and high school, playing crazy games, worshiping a crazy, awesome God. Some students got to be down in the meadow and just have fun. That's where our junior hires were. And the theme for that was, "Armady, who's your captain?" and they talked about who is your captain and really drove that home. And so that was really cool. Our high schoolers got to go up to a camp called Wildwood, and that is up in the mountains. And awesome, because if you've never seen teenagers without cell phones, you kind of get this thing going on. Does anybody know what time it is? They can't have watches. It's great. It's great. And so they go up there to completely get away and to hear from God. And their theme this year was theology and how vast God is. And it was phenomenal. Really good stuff. I have two stories to share. We are going to get a video for you guys because I love pictures. But I got two stories to share because I want to thank you guys for your financial support, for your prayer support. I'm so blessed to see what God's doing on our teens, and I want you guys to know about it. So first one is a high schooler. We're up at Wildwood Camp. This is after the speaker has talked. There's a big old bonfire going, and they said, if you want to stay behind and talk to somebody, stay behind. And so I had a couple students stay behind, but this particular student stayed behind and just kind of sitting there, kind of quiet. I had another leader up there talking with him, and I really felt God saying, hey, go over and talk to him. So I said, okay, God. You know, God talks, try to say, okay. Okay, God, what's going on? And walk over there, and I was like, hey, how you doing? And the student's like, well, it's confirmed. Okay, say more about that. And he says, you know, I felt this a little bit last year, but I really wasn't sure. And it's confirmed again that I feel God's calling me to be a preacher.
Amen.
So, amen. So cool stuff, man. And we talked about what that looks like and how we're going to get them plugged in a little bit and various very cool things. And he says, you know, I just want to do what God wants me to do. And I want to tell people about Jesus. And I said, that's awesome.
Real estate, yeah.
So that's one cool story. The other cool story was junior high camp, right? Junior hires, we just run around and we play games. No, not our junior hires. I was in cabin time and I was connecting with a bunch of students. And this student starts talking to me and he goes, asking like these big questions and questions about worship. And why do people raise their hands when they worship? I don't get it. Why do, you know, what does this mean? What does this mean? And so we got into it. I'm a little bit passionate about worship. And so we started talking about it. And I asked him questions. I was like, so, you know, have you ever just giving it to God and raised your hand in worship? And he's like, no, I'm always a little scared. I don't know what people are going to think about me. And for a junior hire to be that real blew me away. So we talked and we prayed a little bit. And the next morning we were singing, I need thee, oh, I need thee, every hour I need thee. And I'm in the front row with a bunch of junior hires, and he's a couple rows behind me. So it's really weird anyway to have this, like, 6'2", 6'3" dude with all these little junior hires. But, you know, I was like, okay, let's see what happens. And I turn around, and they're singing, I need thee, every hour I need thee. And his hands are raised up to God.
Amen. Amen.
So really cool stuff. Amen. Amen. Really cool stuff's going on with our junior hires and our high schoolers and our teenagers. And I want to say thank you, thank you, thank you for your prayers, for praying for us, for strength as we got up there and spent the whole week up there, for your financial support, and for supporting this church, because I believe that God's doing some awesome ministries in this church. So thank you, thank you, thank you. I'll get you guys the video here pretty soon.
Good. Thanks, Chris. Don't you wish you had a little energy? I love it. I love it, Chris. Thank you very, very much. Hey, great things happen at youth camp. 1960, third Thursday of June, I walked down a long wooden center aisle on a rainy night and gave my life to Christ. And that happened at church camp. So good things happen. I'm excited about a young man in our church recognizing at this stage in of life, God has called him to preach. Can't wait to get a hold of him. Just can't wait for that. I'm excited. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us. I'll give you a heads up now. Communion is going to be at the very end. Guys, come on down. Communion is going to be at the very end of the service, okay? So that's the very last thing we're going to do. All right? So if you're visiting with us, please know communion is open to everybody who's here. The only qualifications God gives to that is, do you have a relationship with His Son, Jesus Christ? There's no judgment by anybody whether you do or whether you don't take communion, of whether you are or not a Christian. Some believers choose not to because there's things going on in their world. They're just on pause for the moment in that area. So just know there is no judgment of whether you do take or don't take, but you are certainly invited. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the things that we've just heard that took place this past week. I heard from a couple of other counselors who'd been up there this week saying this was an awesome, awesome camp for our kids. So I can't wait to hear more of the stories. But Father, thank you for your story. The story where you so loved the world that you gave your one and only Son so that we would not perish, but we would have everlasting life. Thank you, Father. I hope that message comes out strong and clear in all that is said and done today. We trust you with the needs of the Mansfield family. We pray for their care and their comfort. We trust you for the Little family, for the Hopalian families. Thank you for your availability to them. We trust you for Jerry's needs this coming week, Lord, and for others who have challenges. For Bill, Father, as he starts his treatment this week, we commit those needs to you and say thanks in advance for your sufficiency. Most of all, at this moment, what I'm praying for, what the desire of my heart is, Lord, is that in what we do in the remainder of our service time today, we'll lift up your Son to a point that this world will go strangely dim and we will see clearly your direction for our lives. For the privilege of giving and sharing today, we say thanks. In the awesome name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, good morning, and thanks for being back. If you missed us last week, then you don't know the deal behind this table. This is just for this sermon, but I didn't finish the sermon last week, so I'm finishing it this week. And the reason, it was something that I wished I could tell you God told me to do this, but, you know, he didn't write it in the sky, and it wasn't an audible voice. But during the week, there was just this overwhelming sense I needed to do something a bit different for this particular sermon. And because I want the attention to be on what is said, not on who's saying it. I don't want it to be distracted by, I have a tendency to move a lot. I like to move a lot. It was hard for me to sit last week. It'll be hard for me to sit again this week. But again, this final sermon in this series that we've been on called Twisted and Unseen. If you've missed a few weeks, you can go to the website. They're on there. If you want the first half of this one, if you missed it last week, it is there. Hopefully it will all come together for you today, even if you did miss it. We've been looking at the fact that in this world, we wonder why there's so much trouble and conflict. And the movie that Fawn is promoing, that Women's Ministry is going to participate in, is right on the money. It's really what started all of this on July 4th weekend. God gave very specific direction to Solomon for the nation of Israel. If you want your nation to turn around, your people have to pray. That didn't start with the king praying. Didn't start with government changing. It started with the hearts of the people praying. And that prompted us to look a little deeper into that same subject. And so for the last 5 weeks, we've been looking at this thing called Twisted and Unseen. What we mean by that is there is a force that's functional in this world that in 21st century culture, we often don't like to talk about them. It almost sounds like voodoo, all right? Sounds like something crazy. But there is a devil that roams this world. He has a couple of names, Satan. Jesus called him the devil, Beelzebub, Lucifer. He's a fallen angel who wanted to be God. As he tried to raise himself up, God cast him down. Satan wants to be God so much that he wants a following. And so he is working in the unseen areas of this world with temptation and influence. And because we can't see him with pointy ears and a pointed tail and a pitchfork in his hand, we often don't recognize his presence and we often don't recognize his influence. It's been around since Adam and Eve. And it'll be around until Jesus Christ comes again. And then he will be confined to ever in the place that has been prepared for him. It's called hell. It's another word we don't like to talk a whole lot about anymore in 21st century. But you see, if there's a heaven for us to gain, there must be a hell for us to shun. You can't have one without the other, because the God who created the one is the God who created the other. You can't have it one way. It's got to be all true, or the whole thing is false. And the way that Satan approaches us is by twisting the truth just a little bit. He doesn't come out and tell us, hey, this God you love is a liar. Follow me. He gets us to take what God has said and say, well, it doesn't mean quite that. And so he twists it just a little bit to get us off track. You might say something kind of like 50 Shades of Grey. That's what Satan is good at. And he probably was the director of that film, by the way. If you saw that one, you probably needed to repent as well. Just a thought, just an observation. Let me review, and then we'll jump into this week. There's a big, big difference. Last week, here's what we looked at. There's a big, big difference between what and what. Do you remember? There's a great, thank you, my wife paid attention to the sermon last week. Nobody else did. She listened to me. There's a great big difference between sin. Of course, she has to, because I quiz her every Sunday afternoon when we go home. That's just a joke, really. There's a great big difference between sin and mistake. You see, I don't really have to ask you to forgive me if I make a mistake. I just can say, I'm sorry, okay? Can we just move on from here? But sin, that's a different thing altogether. And here's the biggest difference. Here's where the twist is in all this. You see, if everything I do wrong can be dumbed down to where it's just a mistake, then that makes me a mistaker, which means I don't have sin. And if I don't have sin, then I'm not a what? I'm not a sinner. And wow, wouldn't that be really cool if I don't ever have to admit I'm a sinner? I'm just a mistaker. But if I'm not a sinner, then I don't have a need for a Savior. You see, if you're a mistaker, then all you have to do is do better. Mistakers just try harder. Mistakers just have to break little nasty habits. Mistakers just have to be a little bit more consistent. They just have to try harder next time. And it occurred to me, actually, this morning at 8 o'clock service, if I'm just a mistaker, do I really even need to try harder? I mean, if all it is I'm a mistaker, then there's no hell for mistakers. Hell was designed for sinners. So if I'm just a mistaker, then forget about even trying harder. But if I'm a sinner, that seems to be more fundamental to who I am. If I am a sinner, then simply trying harder isn't going to get it done. Because if I'm a sinner, then I probably owe somebody something, and it's probably more than I can afford to pay. I probably deserve something that I don't even really want to know what it's going to be. If I'm a sinner, trying harder is not going to help me. If I'm a sinner, I need a Savior, a rescuer. So the twist that we live in this 21st century culture and with our world and with the issues that we deal with when it comes to the subjects of guilt and shame, and by the way, we talked about that last week, if I just make a mistake, is there any guilt? If I just make a mistake, is there any shame? Then why do you feel guilt and shame? That doesn't come from mistakes. That comes from sin. So we'd rather not have sin. I tell you, those unseen influences are functional today. So see, if I admit that I'm a sinner, then I need a Savior. I would rather just make mistakes, which makes me a mistaker, which means I just try harder. We kind of wrapped things up last week with this quote. Came across it years ago, and I love it. Sin, not mistakes. Sins will take us farther than we wanted to go. It will keep us longer than we want it to stay. And it will cost us far, far more than we are able to pay. Now, if that wasn't enough, let's That's where we jump in this week. Jesus comes along, and he just stirs the pot a little bit. He whacks the hornet's nest. Did you guys ever do that? Did you ever get a broom and just whack the hornet's nest, all right, and then run like crazy? My grandpa McLean one time, I was probably 6 years old, used to live over on Peach Avenue. And I was out with him. We were getting eggs out of the chicken coop, and he looked up and he saw a hornet's nest in the corner of the chicken coop. And he said, "Son, I'm going to teach you something I read about." He said, "I read that if you hold your breath, you can pull a hornet's nest down and they can't sting you while you're holding your breath." So Grandpa got on a little stepladder. He held his breath and he reached up there and he pulled down the hornet's nest. He taught me something. It doesn't work, all right? They can still sting you even when you hold your breath, all right? But Jesus pulls down a hornet's nest right in the middle of the room, and he makes a mess of the whole thing that the Pharisees had been trying to work out in their religious activity. You see, Jesus comes along in his ministry, and he taught two very opposing ideas that seems like they shouldn't even come out of the same person's mouth, particularly in the same sermon. And Jesus did that in Matthew chapter 5. If you want to turn there, I'm going to highlight a few things in just a minute. But he basically came along and he made Jesus, can you believe this? Jesus came along and in this sermon, he made everybody feel worse. We don't often think of Jesus doing that, but at this particular moment, he did. And the reason he made everybody feel worse is because the Pharisees had been dumbing down sin. The Pharisees had been coming up with their own rules because they were easier than God's rules. They came up with rules like on the Sabbath day you can't walk more than so many feet. And so what they did is they would put a rope or a string in their pocket that was the length of how far they could walk. And if they got to the end of their rope, then they just had to sit down in that spot and wait till the next evening when the Sabbath was over. Because they were trying to prove they could be righteous. If we come to the end of our rope, just sit down. You're going to be okay. All right? Just stay right there. So they came up with things that made them feel righteous. Because they didn't really want to be sinners. They had dumbed down God's way. Sounds much like the 21st century, doesn't it? We've dumbed down what God has called wrong and sinful. And we call it mistakes or Mother Nature. And so, Jesus comes along and he says, "Guys, I'm going to raise the bar. I'm going to share some things with you that it's going to probably drive you crazy. Because you are worse than you think you are. You thought you were just kind of bad?" Jesus said, no, you're really bad. You thought you were good? No. You're not good. The Bible, in fact, goes on to say there are none good. No, not one. And Jesus proved it to him. You thought you were righteous? Oh, no. You are not a righteous person. Let me just highlight a couple of things. After he shares with them the good news of the Beatitudes and he talks about them being salt and light in the world, then he addresses some specific subjects. He deals with things like murder. Verse 21 of chapter 5, "You've heard that it was said to people long ago, 'Do not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment.'" You've heard that? "Here's what I'm going to tell you," Jesus said, "but I tell you that anyone who is angry with his brother will be subject to judgment." What's he saying? He's saying, you think about when you kill somebody that you're going to be judged. I'm telling you, when you conceive in your heart that you think you might want to kill them, you've already done it. Remember last week? Sin is not the act. The act is the fruit of the sin. One of the last things I sent you out of here on was a definition I learned several years ago that I think is the best definition of sin there is, and that is being independent of God. Whatever I do, even things that appear to be good, like preaching, can be sin because we're doing it independent of God. And Jesus says, hey, the law said, don't kill, don't murder. I'm telling you, when you conceive in your heart, you've already done it. I raised the bar. He drops on down, and then he talks about adultery, and he said, you've heard it said, The law says, don't commit adultery. I'm telling you that when a man has lust in his heart for a woman, he's committed adultery already. He raised the bar. He then talks about the subject of divorce, and then he talks about oaths. If you make a promise and you don't keep it, then he talks about justice or vengeance from the Old Testament, an eye for an eye. And he says, hey, I'm going to raise the bar. Forget that. I'm not abolishing an eye for an eye. I'm raising the bar. Rather than an eye for an eye, love your enemy who took your eye. Let him keep his. Love him. He raised the bar. And you could just keep going, giving to the needy and the subject of prayer and fasting. Jesus raised the bar. It's like he came along with one message that was extraordinarily condemning, that said, nobody's good enough to be in my Father's favor. And then he comes right along after that and he says, oh yeah, by the way, God loves you. You are no good. You are unrighteous. You are unholy. You never can be good enough. But guess what? My Father loves you so much, he sent me to die for you. People are thinking, well, wait a minute, Jesus, which is it? Either it's terrible or God loves me. Which is it? And Jesus says, ladies and gentlemen, it's both. You're terrible and God loves you. You're worse than you thought, and God and I love you more than you could ever imagine. Have you come to that point in your life? Pharisees needed to. And maybe you need to. Don't fall for the hype. This hype's been around since Genesis chapter 3. I invite you to turn to Genesis chapter 3. When you've had a Bible long enough, sections just pull out. So here's my Bible, but here's Genesis chapter 3. It just sort of fell out this morning. So it works good for me today. Okay? So here's Genesis 3. I believe that we're living in a time where acceptance plays a big part in our society. We're living in a time where everybody is looking for an excuse to do what they want to do. You will find in the Old Testament, in several of the Old Testament historical records, the book of Judges in particular, it says generation after generation after generation, they did that which was right in their own eyes. They did that which was right in their own eyes. And we're living in a time where everybody wants the green light to do that which is right in their own eyes. We're living in a time when anything goes. Just let it flow, society. We want what we want so bad that we'll do just about anything and we'll listen to just about anybody to get it. But this has been true, folks, not just since the 1960s and 70s. This has been true since the Garden of Eden. It's been true since the beginning of time. In spite of the fact of what God already said in Genesis 2, 16 and 17, Adam and Eve had already set their sights on what they wanted, and all they needed was justification to act on what they wanted. But I need to tell you, it doesn't matter who's trying to convince you to move contrary to what God has already said. Don't be like Adam and Eve. Don't get caught up in the madness and in the drama. Don't believe the hype. And there's three reasons we shouldn't believe the hype. You see, when you start to believe the hype, we will find ourselves in the midst of the setup. And that we can read about in chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Follow along with me. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals that the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, did God really say that you must not eat from the tree in the garden? And the woman said, this is always the part that fascinates me most about this story. She talked back to a snake. I'm not really scared of snakes. Shelly's terrified of them, all right? Her family sent her a picture of a big 6.5-foot snake that was in her parents' driveway. Now she won't get out of the car until I get out of the car first, okay? She really doesn't like snakes. Snakes don't bother me all that bad. But I promise you, I will run fast from a snake when it starts talking to me. That would scare me. He can rattle all he wants to, and that's not going to bother me all that much. But let him talk to me, I'm going to run. Eve just starts talking back. She said, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden. And she should have stopped there. There should have been a period, because that's what God said. But she puts an and in there. Never put an and to God's period. Important principle. Never put an and to God's period. And you must not touch it. That was not found in Genesis chapter 2. And you will die. Number 4, verse 4. You will not surely die, the serpent said to the woman. He subtly suggested something different. Now he comes out and out and says, you won't die. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. This also fascinates me. The Bible tells us that when God formed Adam and Eve, whose image were they made in? So who were they already like? God. This is the twist in the garden. I can't stay down. This is the twist in the garden. Satan had wanted to be God himself. And so he rebelled against God in heaven as a created angel. And God cast him down to earth. Satan still had the desire to be God, and to be God, you had to have your own creation. And he went after Adam and Eve. If he could get Adam and Eve to realize that if they ate of that tree, they would become like God, so who would they become like when they ate of the tree of knowledge of good and evil? Who would they be like? Satan. He was going to be God one way or another. And he wanted Adam and Eve to no longer be in the image of God the Creator, but he wanted Adam and Eve to be in the image of Satan, who wanted to be God. Blows me away. Satan is subtle, cunning, and crafty, and calculating. John 8:44 we looked at several weeks ago, for he is a liar and he's the father of all lies. One of his main objectives to convince us to do something we shouldn't do is found in verse 1, and he said to the woman, has God said? When we listen to the devil, he hopes to do two things. He makes us question God's word, and he makes God look harsher than he is. He makes God look more mean. We need to understand that in the garden they only had one rule. Don't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Hundreds of trees to eat from, but they passed them to get to this one. The devil will try to set us to fail, but don't believe the hype. Hype is deception. Eve begins to make her conscience feel better by justifying her actions. He, God, said, don't eat and don't touch. The enemy will convince us to think negative about God. He'll make the burden seem to be heavier than what God said it was. We say things like this, well, I can't do that because my parents said I couldn't. I can't do that because my church is against it. I can't do that because God won't let me. When you and I have a right, healthy, and understanding relationship with God, you know what the reply ought to be instead of I can't because somebody won't let me? Is I can't do that because that won't glorify God. I don't want to do that because I will bring dishonor to God. I don't want to do that because I love God. Understand, this is all a setup. The problem is, when subtlety stops working, the devil flat out calls God a liar. Verse 4, you will not surely die, for God knows in the day you eat, you'll be like him, knowing good from evil. The enemy will entice us and hook us with half-truths. He's just showed Eve the pleasurable things, but he left out the end results. Catch that. Satan will show us pleasurable things, but he will leave out the end results. Sin may be pleasurable. In fact, the Bible says sin is pleasurable for a season, but the end thereof is death. And the truth of the matter is, the death will show us the pleasures of drinking, but he'll not reveal to us the consequences of alcoholism. The evil one will show us the pleasures of illicit sex, but not the results of STDs and untimely pregnancies and abortion. He will show us the pleasures of drugs, but he will not show us the results of addiction. And I need to tell you, don't believe the hype. Don't get caught in the trap of the setup, because one who gets caught in the setup will eventually sell out. Verse 6 tells us that they will make a moral decision based upon physical lusts instead of spiritual truths. In essence, what they were saying, hey, if it feels good, do it. But don't believe that hype, because when we decide to make our own moral rules based on what we think and not on what God says, it's like making us God, and it makes Satan feel like he's God. Understand that as human beings, we have appetites. We have appetites for things like food and power and money and sex. And these appetites aren't wrong to have, but they must stay under control. Every time I go to a restaurant, do you know what the part of the menu I look at first? I look at desserts. I want to see, do I need to save a little room? And then they bring out a big dessert. And then I can't let it go to waste. So I send it to my waist. I just came up with that, by the way. That was good. I like that. But it's time to get our appetites under control. The Bible says no temptation has overtaken us except what is common to man, but God is faithful, and He will allow the temptations not to go beyond what, listen to this, this is what's important, what Christ is able to resist in us. It's not our ability to say no to temptation. It is Christ's ability to say no on our behalf. We just have to let Him say no. We just often close the door and don't let Him be involved. Don't believe the hype, because once you've been set up, that's going to lead to a cover-up. Verses 7 through 13. Covering up your sin may hide it from others, but guess who it doesn't hide from? God. Adam and his wife hid themselves, verse 7, from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. They tried to hide behind things. The first thing they hid behind were fig leaves. Okay. Elephant in the room. What did they cover up with the fig leaves? Yeah, shame is the right thing to say in church. Yeah, they covered up the private parts. Okay? Now, those private parts had been exposed already. What changed? Their heart. That which God created beautiful. They're still a husband and wife. Nothing wrong with looking at each other naked. But all of a sudden, their thinking was perverted. And even with their own spouse, they tried to cover up their shame. The other thing the Scripture says they tried to hide behind were the trees. Why'd they hide behind trees? Who were they hiding from? God, yeah, they were hiding from God. Get this, I never thought of this till this week I came across it. I love this. What was the job of Adam and Eve in the garden? What job did God give to them? Tending the garden. Get this. They tried to hide their sins behind the good things they had been doing. Don't we do the same thing? God, I did this and this and this last week. It's okay if on the weekend I do this, right? I mean, look at what I did. It's okay. We hide behind the good things because we look at sin as the fruit. When sin is not the fruit, sin is the choice in the heart. That's why God has to expose and convict us when we try to cover up. When we hear His voice in our daily prayer, when we hear His voice when we're reading the Scriptures, when we hear His voice at church, or just when our conscience is being challenged, God says, Tim, where are you? Steve, where are you? Do you realize when I said Tim, I just caught four guys in this service? There's one over here, and there's two over here, and there's one up here. I've never been in a church with so many dang Tims in my life. Debbie, where are you? Fawn, where are you? That is God's conviction. But notice, God did not wait for Adam and Eve to come looking for Him. God demonstrated His love when they became sinners, and He went looking for them. Why? Because when we fall for the setup, we end up with a cover-up, And God must expose the cover-up to bring us back to the place where we need Him. But instead of coming clean, Adam did what we all do. He began to blame others for his mistake. God, that woman you gave me, that woman he couldn't wait to put his hand on as soon as God introduced him. All of a sudden, it's her fault. And God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" And she said, "That serpent, that talking thing." Understand, the cover-up is nothing more than an excuse for our actions, our choices. The devil made me do it. Flip Wilson? Yeah. My parents didn't raise me right. I've got so much peer pressure. Well hey, everybody else is doing it. It's acceptable now. How about this one? This is a new good one I've been hearing lately. I deserve it. I deserve to be happy. I deserve this vacation. I deserve this outlet. Ladies and gentlemen, what we all deserve when we discover that we're sinners is death. That's what we deserve. God, by His incredible grace, offers us life. You see, it's always somebody else's fault. It's never about our gossiping tongue. It's about the horrible thing they did. It's never about that lie. It's about how we couldn't trust that person with the truth. Eve started it, but Adam was right there going along with it. Don't believe the hype, because believing in the hype will cause us to be caught in a setup by the enemy, and the setup will lead us to a cover-up. But for every setup and cover-up, there's always going to be a time to pay up. Understand that nothing in this life comes without a consequence. The Bible says in Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 and 8, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that will you also reap. For he who sows to the flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will have everlasting life." When you get caught in the hype of the world, you're destined to be set up by the devil, lured into all kind of sin. As a result of your setup, you'll find yourself in the midst of a cover-up to hide what you've done. But the day will come when it's time to pay up. Whatever we have done in the dark will be exposed to the bright light of God's judgment. But aren't you glad that we are not under the same penalty as Adam and Eve? Aren't you glad that God provided a way of escape for us? Aren't you glad that God provided what it took for us to be delivered from the price of the setup and the cover-up? In your Bibles, and this is a verse you ought to mark, you ought to redline it, underline it, put stars by it, in Orville Little's Bible service I did yesterday. He didn't write a lot of notes in there. He wrote the date and the preacher who preached a sermon. I think he was checking up on his pastors to make sure they didn't repeat too often. But every once in a while in his Bible, I would find a star by a verse. And I found a couple of verses that had five stars by them. That must have been an important verse to him. Here's one you ought to five star in your Bible. Romans 5, 8, 9, and 10. "But God demonstrated His own love towards us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than having now been justified by His blood, we shall be saved from wrath through Him." Wrath, that means hell, guys. "For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of His Son, much more have we been reconciled, shall we be saved by His life." I don't know about you, but I'm exceedingly glad that God sent His Son to pay the price and the penalty for my cover-up. The sooner we embrace the fact that we're a sinner, the sooner we are enabled to engage in God's grace in our own life. The sooner we are able to experience forgiveness, the pardon for our sin, the sooner we are enabled to engage in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Because at the cross, Jesus took our shame. At the cross, Jesus took our guilt. At the cross, Jesus paid the full price of our sin, and He took away our obligation to the Father. Christians who find relief from life's greatest burdens of sin are those who express the heart of Ephraim out of the book of Jeremiah when he said, "After I strayed, I repented." Have you strayed? Have you strayed? Then repent. "After I came to understand, I beat my chest. I was ashamed and humiliated because I bore the disgrace of my youth." Christians who find relief from this great burden were like the prodigal who came to his senses and confessed, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your child. Treat me like one of your hired men." We know the end of that story, right? He didn't treat him like a hired servant. He put a new robe on his back and a new ring on his finger and new shoes on his feet. And he said, "My son, which was lost, is found." God wants to say that to you. But first of all, you have to admit that you're a sinner and not a mistaker. Christians who find relief from these great burdens are like the tax collector who prayed, "God, have mercy on me, a sinner." These are the hard attitudes of Christians who enjoy the full grace of God in their lives. So here's my question. Has there ever been a time in your life as an adult that you've said to God, "God, I don't want to do this anymore. God, this is not about my mistakes. I've discovered over the last week or two, that's a cover-up, that's rationalization." Has there ever been a time when you said, "God, I have sinned, and beyond just sinning, God, I'm a sinner. It's not a second chance I need. It's not a reboot and a restart, God. I need a Savior." Have you ever told God that? Have you ever said to God, "God, I believe that Jesus Christ came to be my Savior, and now, personally, as an act of my own will, I want to receive your Son as my personal Savior, Lord, and life. I am going to transfer my trust from my ability to get it right, from my ability to pay back and to make myself happy. I'm transferring my trust from what I can do to what your Son has already done for me." Have you ever done that? Or have you just been coming to New Hope, hoping that you'll get it right? I got news for you. The bar is set much higher than attending church at New Hope. The bar has been set at the cross of Jesus Christ. If you try to come to New Hope and get your way in, you will fail. If you come to the cross at New Hope, you've got a ticket stamped: "Enter in, my good and faithful child." If you haven't ever done that, I want to give you a chance to do that today. And let me tell you who needs to do that right now. If while I have been talking last week or this week, you said, "Oh, I get it. I never realized that before," then that's you. You need to do that. If your heart has, during these two sermons, if it has been beating funny, that's what the Bible calls conviction. That is God's voice telling you, "I love you." That's God saying, "Bill, Joe, Bob, Mary, Kathleen, where are you? I want you to come into my family." Then I'd like to lead you in a prayer, and this prayer is going to kind of go like this. If you don't like these words, make up your own. There's not a magic formula, but this prayer is going to express to God that you're ready to make the transfer. It's going to sound a little bit like this: "God, I recognize that I'm not a mistaker. I'm a sinner. I've sinned against you, and I owe you a debt. I don't think I could ever be good enough to pay that debt. I believe when Jesus died on the cross, he paid the debt for my sin. And today, as a man or a woman, I'm receiving freely that gift. I'm transferring my trust from my ability to be completed to the finished work of Christ on the cross." You see, that's what it means to become a Christian. Nothing more, nothing less, nothing else. A prayer of confession. I don't know how in the 21st century world that people have thought that good people go to heaven. If you're just good, you'll go. That's a twist from the unseen world. Good people don't go to heaven. You know who does? Forgiven people go to heaven. A thief on a cross didn't have time to be good, but he had time to be forgiven. Forgiveness is found in the death and resurrection of Christ. If you have never had that interaction, if you've never made that exchange with the Heavenly Father, I'm going to beg you, why don't you do it right now? Would all of us, well, let's just all bow our heads right now. If you have never admitted that you were a sinner and you need a Savior, pray along with me in your mind, your heart. Say it out loud if you want to, but something like this. Heavenly Father, I'm a sinner, and I need Jesus to be my Savior. Today I'm going to transfer my efforts and my works, my consistency and my promises and my commitments. I'm transferring all of my trust from what I intend to do to what you have done for me. I'm placing my faith in your Son, Jesus Christ, as the full and final payment of my sin. Father, thank you for your forgiveness. Please welcome me into your family. I love you. And I'm so incredibly grateful right now. In Jesus' name. You don't have to do this. Keep your heads bowed, if you would, for just another half a minute. But if you've prayed that prayer this morning, would you just quietly raise your hand and put it back down? You can give God thanks throughout this day for you receiving Christ. Okay? Yes? Yes? All right? Okay. Father, thank you for those who raised their hand and for those, Father, who prayed that prayer for the very first time. Thank you. They're now part of your family. For those who are already part of your family and they raised their hands because they wanted to make sure the slate was clean, no dirt on the feet. Thank you, Father, for that as well. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to share in communion.